Speakers, publishers, consultants, coaches, and info marketers unite. The Speaking of Wealth Show is your roadmap to success and significance. Learn the latest tools, technologies, and tactics to get more bookings, sell more products, and attract more clients. If you're looking to increase your direct response sales, create a big-time personal brand, and become the go-to guru, the Speaking of Wealth Show is for you. Here's your host, Jason Hartman.
Welcome to the Speaking of Wealth Show. This is your host, Jason Hartman, where we discuss profit strategies for speakers, publishers, authors, consultants, coaches, info marketers, and just go over a whole bunch of exciting things that you can use to increase your business, to make your business more successful and more passive and more automated and more scalable. So we will be back with a great interview. Be sure to visit us at speakingofwealth.com. You can take advantage of our blog, subscribe to the RSS feed, and many other resources for free at speakingofwealth.com. And we will be back with a great interview for you in less than 60 seconds.
Are you interested in a property outside of our network? Do you need a second opinion? No problem. Let Jason's experts evaluate the deal. Our deal evaluator is only $50. For more information, go to jasonhartman.com now.
My pleasure to welcome Professor Corey Olsen to the show. He is an English professor who started a podcast about 2.5 years ago, has a great story about it, and I think you're going to learn a lot from his experience, and so thankful to have him with us tonight. Corey, thanks for joining us. Appreciate it. How are you?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
Well, my pleasure. So you are an English professor, and
that's right.
You have a particular specialty, it sounds like.
That's right, yes. I mean, I have sort of a dual specialty in medieval literature and also in fantasy literature, especially the works of J.R.R. Tolkien.
Fantastic. And you as a professor, you were saying before we started taping, you were saying that, of course, and people know this, that professors are under tremendous pressure to publish. And usually they're publishing articles in academic journals that few people read, and or they're publishing textbooks, which have a fairly small market as well. Now, have you participated in that world of publishing, or was podcasting really the route you wanted to take?
Well, I basically started off doing that. You know, I mean, that's what we're trained to do in graduate school. And I did some of that. I've published a couple articles and, you know, was sort of working on some things. But really, the thing that kind of got to me is that I became sort of dissatisfied as I was planning out these articles and writing these things, basically thinking about who my audience is, which is very, very few people. That basically the way that academic publishing has become, largely through economic pressures, academic journals and academic books are generally just simply priced out of the range of normal consumers, even people who would be interested in reading them. So that basically I was finding that the academic conversation was often just a kind of a closed conversation among a small group of scholars. And I, you know, there's definitely value in that, and I definitely enjoy talking to other scholars. But, you know, for myself, that's never what I was most excited about. And what I was really excited about was actually trying to reach a wider audience and reach more people. And for me, I decided, instead of taking that time to work on a few more articles or maybe work on a scholarly monograph, I decided to instead to go the media route and be a podcaster. So I chose podcasting really not because I knew anything about the genre. I really didn't. But basically, I was a teacher. And, you know, what I am most comfortable with is teaching in class. So I wanted to do something where I could be using my own voice and I could be kind of appealing to my own lecture style. I thought that that would be, you know, I thought about starting a blog, but really, I kind of wanted to involve my voice and do more of what I normally do in teaching. So that's why I went the podcast route. And it has been a lot of fun. And being able to reach out to people, there is a very dynamic audience out there of people who not only just are fans of Tolkien, you know, not just people who are kind of Peter Jackson fans and Orlando Bloom fans and that kind of thing, but people who are really interested in engaging in these works in ways that just delight any English professor. I mean, there's such a hunger out there for a real academic conversation that involves a wider audience of people. There are many, so many, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people out there, I found, who really want to take part in this kind of conversation and have been thirsty for it. And it was remarkable. As I said, I had no idea what I was doing. I just started posting things. I figured out how to do an RSS feed, posted it to iTunes, and it just kind of took off.
Yeah, so what's interesting, though, is since you're a professor, do you have access to podcasting in a different way? iTunes has something called iTunes University, or
yes.
iTunes U. Now, are your podcasts published in the iTunes University category, or the regular category where all the rest of us are?
Both, actually. I do have access to iTunes U, and that has been a really good thing. The way that works is that goes through individual colleges and universities. So Washington College has a sort of, well, site isn't exactly the right word, but they have a thing on iTunes U. They have a center on iTunes U, and they started carrying my podcast. But I had been doing it on iTunes previously. It was basically once my podcast had established itself and had a large number of followers, then basically there were people in my college who came to me and said, "Hey, we're wanting to start an iTunes U site. Can we put your podcast on there too?" And so they did. But it's separately maintained. It's not connected automatically to the RSS feed that I put out. So actually, it only has the episodes that the tech people at my college have gone through and uploaded themselves. So it's actually kind of a subset of them. But it does go to a different pool of people, people who are really seeking out academic content. And that's really good. It was we had a kind of exciting period at the end of 2010 when the podcast got kind of picked up by, you know, how iTunes sort of selects podcasts to put on their buttons and, you know, what's hot and all of that. And my podcast got flagged on the iTunes U and was up in the top 10 charts for most downloaded lecture series for a while, for about a month and a half, actually, at the end of 2010. That was kind of a fun and exciting time.
Well, looking at iTunes now, you've got 196 ratings, and your average rating is 5 stars. So congratulations on that.
Thank you.
You've got a whole bunch of reviews here in addition to the ratings. And I guess you've got 142 episodes so far?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And it looks like, just to give the listeners some metrics, it looks like the time for your episodes is really all over the board. I see episodes here that are 14 minutes, 7 minutes, and then I see one that's an hour and 4 minutes, 49 minutes, 32 minutes. So you're really kind of all over the board time-wise, it sounds like, right?
It is, yeah. Now, the short ones are more unusual. My average section is probably an hour long, sometimes even up to 2 hours long. I have sort of different subsets that I do. Sometimes I have some just straight up lecture series that I've done where I did a lecture. I started off, the very first episodes I did was just doing a lecture series working my way through J.R.R. Tolkien's The Hobbit. Not exactly chapter by chapter, but like one little chunk of chapters at a time, going through the book in 8 lectures. And those were sort of shorter because they were kind of more pre-scripted stuff. It wasn't really fully spontaneous, so they tended to be shorter. Later on, I started adding some other features. I started doing some just one-on-one conversations with students or other Tolkien experts. I started recording live class sessions. There are 2 of the courses that I taught at Washington College, and it's simply my class with I just mic'd myself during a class I was teaching. And got the permission of the dean and the school to post that both to iTunes U and to my podcast feed. There's another a seminar that I did called the Silmarillion Seminar, which was a group of people who were just my podcast listeners. I just posted on my Facebook page one day and said, "Hey, who would like to participate in a study with me where we'll have an online audio discussion and we'll go through the Silmarillion chapter by chapter, you know, for like 40 weeks." And I got about 20 people who did that with me, and we would sit down for 2 hours a night, one night a week, and we did that for, I think we have 40 sessions, and that was really a wonderful group of people, and that just worked out really great. But those tend to be longer episodes. And right now, my latest series has been one that we're calling Riddles in the Dark, and it's specifically focused on the upcoming movie of The Hobbit by Peter Jackson that's going to be released in December. And we're looking at the story of The Hobbit and sort of issues for adaptation in the film, and kind of speculating what the Peter Jackson people are going to be doing with these things in the film. And kind of talking about what we see in the books, and you know, we're doing a set of predictions as to what we expect to see in the movies and stuff. It's been a lot of fun. So all these different segments that we're doing, and again, I would just emphasize these are all things that I completely made this up as I went along. As I said, this was not like a well thought out strategy on my part from the beginning. It was really just responding to demand. This, you know, my podcast totally started with me having a passion for teaching a thing and putting it out there, finding that there were a lot of people who were enthusiastic about it, and then from there just responding to their demands. When I put this stuff out there, as I said, I just started doing lectures, which people really liked and still really enjoy, but they wanted to take part in the conversation. They wanted to be able to speak too. So I started doing more and more multi-directional stuff, you know, whether it be interviews or call-in sessions or class sessions and things like that. So that just kind of grew very organically as we added new things and started to do more stuff, and that's been really a tremendous amount of fun. But I said that's really all been driven by the sort of requests and demands of listeners, and that's been really great.
Corey, one of the things I find about podcasting and in my years of doing it, and one of the things I just love about it is that it gives you this tremendous networking opportunity with other people who may be guests on your shows that you wouldn't normally get to network with. You may not have access to them. I mean, for example, just you and I talking right now. If I was some guy that just called you out of the blue and I said, hey, I hear you have this podcast, you probably wouldn't take the time to talk to me, or you might be very charitable and do that. I don't know you that well, obviously. But it gives you a great access to experts, to mm-hmm. education, and to just a network of people. I cannot tell you how that's improved my life and my business life. And when you said you did that 40-episode series and you got all these other people involved, right? How many people would you say that you've involved in your podcast?
That have actually taken part, like spoken on my podcast?
Yeah,
gosh.
Or in some way been involved.
Yeah, in
even
some
in
way
content
been involved.
Development or yeah. Whatever.
I mean, I would say over the years, at least 40, 50 people.
Yeah, and that's only 2.5 years we're talking about, not
right,
many years.
Right. Yes, exactly. And that's you know, still, you know, in some ways, really, my podcast was sort of the beginning. You know, what I'm doing, one of the main things I'm doing now is I'm essentially launching an entire online academic program, which was really just inspired by my podcast. I mean, it's, you know, again, continuing that same kind of organic growth. After I had for a while been doing these other sessions and call-in sessions and escalating to the point of actually doing live online seminar discussions with listeners from around the country and around the world, even. We had a couple who were you know, in Canada, one in South America. And anyway, so once we had actually gotten to that point, the next question that everybody kept asking me was, can we take classes for credit? You know, could we actually do real classes? And I, you know, eventually began to say, well, why shouldn't we? So basically that's what I've done. So I've ended up actually founding a new online institution called the Mythgard Institute, which is designed, we're running a master's degree program now designed exactly for the people, you know, who are my podcast listeners, you know, and for that whole group of people who were so interested in doing this kind of thing. To me, when you talk about networking, one of the things which was always so valuable for me is you've got this incredible opportunity to reach people who are interested to hear what you have to say, people who are interested in your subject and your topic. I think it's the really exciting thing about the whole internet age. You know, instead of just having a group of people who are deciding what gets put on TV or deciding what gets put on the radio, and you as a consumer are just sitting there and you have to kind of take what's given to you. Now we have, you know, people making their own decisions and driving programming themselves, and so basically
it's the ultimate democracy. It really is.
Yes.
It's totally democratic.
It really is.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, and for me, you know, in my little world, it's one of the things that I've been really excited about, the democratization of academia itself and of education. I mean, that's something that I'm also really excited about, to take that same kind of principle and really to open up academia, not only the way in which my podcast is kind of a move towards opening up scholarship and academic publishing, but also, you know, through my institute, we're also working to open up classes as well. So I personally, I find that very exciting, and I'm really interested to see. I don't think that process is complete at all yet. I think that there's still some pretty exciting times to come.
Well, let's talk about a couple comments. I've got a couple of things here. First of all, the democratization of the internet now, or the democratization of media and academia and education in general. And so that is definitely true, because it's no longer vetted. People don't need to ask for permission. If you've got something to say, you just get to go direct to the listener, and they get to decide how valuable what you have to say is. And the other part of it, not just the democratization and the access to the listener, but the concept of the long tail. And the long tail, for those of you who may not have heard of the long tail concept, is really the internet. Look at your podcast. Professor Olsen has this podcast, and it is very niche oriented. I mean, how specific is that? It's not just about it's not just about English. It's not just about a certain brand of literature per se. It's about Tolkien specifically. I mean, it is long tail specific. So people who have really narrow particular interest, they can go right there by searching in iTunes or on any search engine and find your content. What a wonderful thing we as podcasters are doing for people. And I say that other people who aren't podcasting yet should be in this world and do it for others and for yourself. Now, you haven't really made any attempt to monetize your show, so far as I understand.
I haven't. And there are two things I'd say. Well, of course, one thing that I have to say up front is I can't, because I'm using Tolkien's name,
right,
which is trademarked.
Well, okay.
So I actually could not. I would require permission from the Tolkien estate, which I don't think they would grant me.
Well, let me just interrupt you there, though.
Yeah.
You can comment on Tolkien's work. You don't need permission for that, I don't believe.
You don't need permission to talk about it, no. But if I were to be using his name, which is trademarked, in the title of my thing, which I were then selling, they could have something to say about that. But the thing is that, you know, for me, I'm glad to say I've always had really good relations with the Tolkien estate. I have a lot of respect for them. I've tried to tell them. I mean, I actually reached out to them before they reached out to me, just to tell them, you know, hey, look, I like, you know, nobody has greater respect for Tolkien than I do. You know, I want you to know that I'm not, you know, some shyster who's going to be trying to, you know, make money on, you know, Tolkien's legacy. I'm just, you know, a scholar and a fan who loves and admires his work, and I'm trying to encourage others to love and admire his work. And I think that they've appreciated that, and that has really sort of borne fruit. But the other thing that I would say about that, apart from, you know, sort of the legal concerns with monetizing my particular podcast directly because of those issues, you know, this, I think, if I had to point to like the single smartest business decision I've ever made in my life, it was doing a free podcast. I actually contemplated when I first started doing it, and before I had thought about these trademark issues, my very, very first plan was, you know, maybe I could charge for them, you know, just a tiny little bit, you know, charge a tiny nominal price for each of my lectures. This is when, as I said at the beginning, I was, you know, writing these sort of this formal lecture series, which took a lot of time and was a lot of work. And so I was thinking, well, you know, maybe I charge a little bit to kind of, you know, compensate myself for my time. And that was my original plan. I decided, no, I'm just going to give it all away for free and just kind of hope that something will come of that down the road. And, you know, I don't think I've ever done anything smarter ever. That was really I mean, like a turning point in my life, essentially, making that decision, because since it was out there and available for everybody, it really spread and also has generated really, really goodwill. I mean, I have found that the kind of not just listenership, but community that I've been able to establish through that has been just priceless and has been the foundation of other things I've been able to go on and do. And I think, you know, to me, I know there were several of my listeners who were kind of worried that, you know, when I reached a certain point of popularity, I was going to start charging for things, you know, one approach that people often take with these kinds of things, you know, like online newspaper subscriptions and whatnot. But I've, you know, I never did that. I never wanted to do that. And instead, you know, what it has enabled me to do, it's enabled me to basically grow from that and build on that platform, which I've maintained, you know, as I've been doing other things. The two other things I've been doing, which are monetized, are the Mythgard Institute. As I say this, you know, I'm now teaching courses online.
That's what I was going to actually mention, is that you didn't monetize the podcast, but
right.
Out of the podcast came the Mythgard Institute, and mm-hmm. that is monetizing, right?
Right. Yes, it is. It is. Now, of course, you know, one of the core philosophies of the Mythgard Institute is to make great education available to people for very little. So my tuition is extremely low by standards of regular colleges and online colleges.
That or regular college commission is or tuition is extremely high. That's what I'd like to say.
Judge for yourself. Yes. Yeah. Yes, exactly. Okay. But anyway, so yeah, I mean, it's not, I'm not yet pricing my own island in the Caribbean on the Mythgard Institute, but anyway, yes, I am charging for classes there. And but of course the other thing that I've done is I've published a book, which has been directly the book that I'm publishing is called Exploring the Hobbit. The title is now Exploring J.R.R. Tolkien's The Hobbit. It's published by Houghton Mifflin Harcourt Company, which is actually the company which publishes Tolkien's works in America. And basically, I have no questions about the fact that it was my podcast almost entirely which got that book published. Most popular publishers like that don't publish scholarly books. I mean, my book is just a discussion, a chapter-by-chapter discussion of The Hobbit in detail. Most works of literary criticism are not picked up by major presses because they're usually not moneymakers, but they knew I had a platform. They knew that I had, you know, I was able to point to the tens of thousands of subscribers that I had, and they were excited about that. So, and basically the book that I have written and which is going to be released in September is a development of that original lecture series that I started writing. I started writing that back in 2007 is when I first started composing it, though the podcast didn't really start up until 2009. But that very first thing I ever wrote is basically the cornerstone of the book that I'm now coming out with too. So, and that's, you know, and that to me has been such a natural and a fun thing. You know, my podcast listeners, far from feeling like now I'm trying to capitalize on them, they're really excited about the book. And you know, we're just having exchanges on Facebook last night about, you know, them wanting to get signed copies and stuff. It's been a lot of fun. So those are for me the two things that have grown out of it, and that's why, again, I say, as far as podcasting goes, I know that there are some people who want to charge for their podcasts and stuff, and it's, you know, possible that you can. There are circumstances in which that might work, but I think part of this whole internet spirit, you know, that we were talking about before, part of that democratizing move is inclusiveness, is, you know, to welcome people in and to bring people in and to establish that kind of a community so that they can see what you're about and know that they are interested in what you have to say. And then, you know, they will be interested, you know, they will order books, and, you know, they will sign up for classes and things like that. Because
yeah,
now
you create the community first, you welcome them in first.
Absolutely.
And I, you know, frankly, I think, and this is probably not your world at all, but I touch into this world a bit, I'll call them the typical internet marketer crowd. A lot of them they won't podcast because they don't want to give away their content for free.
Right.
And I think they're being incredibly stingy by and large.
Yes.
And frankly, I think they're actually shooting themselves in the foot. I think they're hurting themselves. They're really missing out on a huge opportunity, because it is such a comfortable way to go when you can establish a long-term relationship with people, give them content, show them who you are, invite them in, and then the trust is built, the relationship is established, the rapport is there, and they are far more receptive to doing business if you have a business back end and if you have a monetization strategy for your shows, to doing business with you. I mean, why wouldn't they be? Versus right. some stranger they're going to find by doing a Google search or the old right. proverbial going through the yellow pages.
You know? Right, which, right.
Yeah.
Right, the 21st century version. Yeah, no, exactly. It's also, you know, similarly, if people are thinking about, you know, establishing a podcast or something really simply as a means to an end, like in order just to do advertising, essentially, and as really, I think that if you don't have a podcast, if you don't have material that you're willing to give away for free just because you're really enthusiastic about it, because you really
love
it.
Then it's not your passion and you don't love it and your heart's not in the right place. Yeah.
And people are going to be able to tell that. I mean, people can smell when they're just being sold to, you know, and so yeah, I mean, I think that that's, you know, to me, that's really the key of the thing. If you have a thing to say, if you have a thing that you really want to talk about, that you really want to share with people, and you can do that, and they can tell, you know, they can tell that you love this, and they can, you know, and they, it's something that they're going to be able to get excited about. They're not just being set up for something, but it's really something genuine. It's, you know, one thing that I was trying to make sure that my audience really understood when I opened the Mythgard Institute last year. It was in July of 2011. And when I opened it, one of the things that I kept saying to people is, this does not mean that the Tolkien Professor podcast is going to be ending. I'm not just kind of rolling it over now into this institute, which I'm going to be charging people for. You know, I've been maintaining the podcast, and I continue to release episodes. And my plan in the short term, and certainly my plan for the long term, is that establishing Mythgard will only enable me to give away more and to do more stuff. I actually have a producer working with me now who is actually someone, one of the participants in my online seminar, who like stayed on and has become my producer, and she's been great. So yeah, I'm basically having the Institute has only increased my own resources for my podcast, enabling me to continue it and expand it. So yeah, but again, it's really more than anything just about being genuine about something that you really love.
Absolutely, and that absolutely works. Let me take a brief pause. We'll be back in just a minute.
Here's your chance to catch up on all of those Creating Wealth shows that you've missed. There's a 3-book set with shows 1 through 60, all digital download. You save $94 by buying this 3-book set. Go ahead and get these advanced strategies for wealth creation. For more details, go to jasonhartman.com.
Well, tell us a little bit about some of your statistics or ratings or any of the metrics on your show. We talked about number of episodes. Are you tracking your downloads? I hope you are.
Audience size is? Yeah, it's awkward. It's actually, I mean, I find that awkward. I really wish, this is one of my sort of small podcasting pet peeves, is the fact that iTunes does not release statistics to podcasters for their regular feeds. I know that they have it because they actually do this for iTunes U. This is one other big difference between iTunes U and iTunes, is that they do release to the schools the detailed statistics for downloads of all of the episodes on their site. So I know iTunes has the technology. I don't know why they don't send these reports to podcasters. I can't imagine it would be that much skin off their backs, but whatever. Anyway, so I really wish that they did that. I've had about in the neighborhood of 3.5 million downloads now over the 2.5 years.
I've just got to say, unbelievable. That's incredible. You know, it really is. Okay, so listen to this, folks. Think about what you're hearing here, okay? This is a professor who would have traditionally maybe published a textbook for a very small market or another type of articles in academic mm-hmm. journals. Mm-hmm. And, you know, maybe your reach would have been a few hundred, 100? Few thousand people, you know? Yeah, a small market for sure, right?
Yeah.
And now, in 2.5 years, with 100 and I think 142 episodes, You have reached 3.5 million people. That is incredible. I mean,
And
incredible.
around the world. I mean, that's of course another thing
Yeah, it's totally
about the internet
global.
thing. It is absolutely global. I get email from people around the world, who listen to my podcast. And I've got a strong following in Europe and Australia. And I've gotten emails from Kosovo and from China. I got this really delightful email from a 12-year-old girl in China who loves Tolkien somehow. And listens to my podcast to improve her English. It's just it's been incredible. And I always love hearing from people,
You, I mean,
but
think of what you could do. You could go to the website meetup.com, and you could have people start meetup groups globally based on Tolkien and your podcast. So it could lead to physical meetings and potential monetization there, or greater influence, greater thought leadership. I mean, the possibilities, folks, are endless with these powerful podcasts. And even if they're not that big, even if you start a podcast and it's not that big, coming from a sales and marketing background myself, the traditional person is reaching one person at a time. We've all been taught in the business world, go to networking events and network. Well, when you do that, you're reaching one person at a time. In the world of sales, call on a client, get on the phone, knock on doors, make things happen. You're reaching one prospect at a time. And here, you've got this wonderful, automated, basically free technology that is available to you and to the consumer. And I mean, look at what someone like, say, an American podcaster, for example, because most of the podcasts, I'm sure, are US-based. I mean, they're global, of course, but I'd say that I bet most of the content by far comes from US sources, okay? Look at what you're doing really for global relationships and, as corny as it sounds, world peace. Okay, because people have a rapport with you. They know you. They know me. I have been in coffee shops. I mean, I remember ordering something at Starbucks and someone hearing my voice and saying, "Aren't you Jason Hartman?" They've never seen my picture. They only heard my voice. Isn't that an incredible thing? Look at
That
all
is a
the
really funny experience
amazing things that come out of it.
when you see somebody do a double take when they hear your voice. Yeah, I've had that experience too. Yeah, no, it's very it's that's extremely rewarding. And the thing is that I and this is one of the things that I feel about this is I feel a little bit sort of funny talking about it because I sort of wish that I had a list of like here are the things that you do in order to establish a successful podcast. Because honestly, it's like I don't really know how it happened. I mean, I know my own, I mean, I can speak to my own enthusiasm for the subject and everything, but it's as far as actual strategy, I had no idea what I was doing. It start
Neither did I in the beginning. I just
yeah,
did it.
it launched by sort of good fortune. I had started, and it was about 2 weeks into after the release on iTunes originally. And I'll never forget the morning that it happened. I had been doing about 30 downloads a day. Somewhere between 20 and 30 was a good day for my first 2 weeks, when it was just out there. And when I first opened it up, and I had three episodes up there, and so that was all I had. And then one morning, I came downstairs for breakfast, and I just like looked at my site statistics and saw that I'd already had 1,500 downloads by 8 a.m. And I was like, whoa, what on earth happened? Well, what happened was I got put in a new and notable window in iTunes. And basically from there, that was it. Like from there, it was, just word of mouth. I never promoted my podcast. It has spread worldwide simply by word of mouth. And again, to me, that's like it's the magic of the internet. I mean,
Now,
that's just the way it is.
have you ever done video podcasting, or is all of your content audio?
I have done for my podcast itself, I've only done audio stuff. And mostly for me, that has just been because, well, basically two factors. On the one hand, video production is so much more time intensive than audio production is. And also, I sort of felt that the net gain would be relatively small.
It's that marginal. Marginal return. Yeah.
Especially for me, because I, you know, it's just, you know, me talking or me sitting and talking with a person. So like, do I spend a lot more effort to do a video version of like, so you can watch me sitting there talking to a person? Like, it just, you know, I think that there are a lot of really excellent video podcasts, but for me, that wasn't really something that I was interested in. Now, you know, when I've with the Mythgard Institute, we do have a YouTube channel with some sort of announcement stuff that I've done and some sample classes, because we record all of our classes, and so there is a bit of a video element there. But with my podcast, no, I've never really done video.
Well, fantastic. Well, what else would you like the listeners to know? What else can they learn from what you've done? Maybe this is a good question. Just talk for just a quick moment about equipment.
Oh, sure.
How are you recording? What are you doing? any tools you use or applications, or do you use WordPress and FeedBurner or all of that kind of stuff?
Basically, I just started using, I mean, I started and I don't do much more than this now. You know, I just bought myself a headset, a USB headset for my laptop. I have a MacBook laptop. I was just recorded using my headset in GarageBand.
Which headset did you use?
It's a Sennheiser headset, but it's really, I mean, under $100. Mm-hmm, I mean, yeah. It's not a fancy
hey,
thing.
That $45 Plantronics one is pretty great.
Yeah. No, I mean, I've got some Plantronics stuff. That's another company that I really like. Yeah. No, I mean, it's very simple. I mean, I've gotten a little bit more sophisticated equipment as time has gone on. I mean, I have a field recorder that I really like. It's a Zoom H4N.
I have that one. Yeah.
Fantastic field recorder. I love this thing. And I've used it to record class. I've used it for interviews. It did this magical thing once, where I was recording a conversation in a bar on disco night. So they were dancing. There was like booming dance music. We could barely hear each other, but somehow the H4 magically like cancels out. You can still hear that the music is happening, but you could actually hear us talking more clearly on the recording than we could hear each other live.
So it was better than the human ear. That's amazing.
It was just incredible. So anyway, I love that thing, but that's something that I bought maybe 2 years in. But yes, I mean, basically it required you don't need you certainly don't need startup capital to begin a podcast. Just, you know, buy yourself a $50 headset and you can use some pretty basic recording apps. I've also used Audacity, which is freeware. And that's a fine recording program. I mean, that's something that I and my producer have used a lot.
When you're using your MacBook and your Sennheiser headset, what are you recording with then?
Usually GarageBand, actually.
Okay. Oh, so are you using Skype and then GarageBand?
Yes, I do. It depends on the thing that I'm doing. If I'm doing a one-on-one conversation, I usually do that over Skype. And then actually the recording program I use when I'm recording Skype, is Audio Hijack. That's my favorite.
So that's just a piece of software you download onto your Mac, right?
Yeah, exactly. And it's not free, but it's cheap. And it just basically records all the sounds on your computer, so you can it does great recordings of Skype, I found. So that's what I used for, you know, that was maybe my very first, other than the headset, maybe my very first investment when I decided to do the call-in shows and stuff. I went out and downloaded a like $20 license for Audio Hijack Pro and was able to record my Skype conversations that way. I use a related program actually by the same company that makes Audio Hijack Pro. It's called ScreenFlow to capture both video and audio when I'm doing my Mythgard classes. That's how I generate the recordings for the Mythgard classes that I post for my students, because if my students can't catch the classes live, I have video and audio recordings of the classes for them. So I use the sort of big brother of Audio Hijack Pro, which is called ScreenFlow for the Mac. But Camtasia is the name of the nearest PC software, I think, to ScreenFlow as far as being able to capture video on screen and also audio. But anyway, I mean, they're really pretty simple stuff. I mean, I've never used a soundboard. You know, I don't have, you know, anything like that.
When I first started, I had the mixer and all that expensive stuff. And I tell you, nowadays, I just use Skype and call recorder and it works great. And a good microphone. I do have a good microphone. Yeah.
But, yes. No, and
really
that
inexpensive
is...
to do this. Very portable too. Anywhere Absolutely. In the world I go, I can record a podcast. It's awesome.
Absolutely. Yeah. No, it's, and that's the other thing I love about the H4 is that you can hook mics up to it and you can connect it to your computer, to your laptop through a USB connection. It's really small and portable. So yeah, that's exactly. It's, you know, whenever I go anywhere, I can have my whole podcasting kit and my carry on, and that's really easy. So yeah, no, there's very little reason for anybody to be scared away from it for tech reasons. It's just not very complicated.
It's not complicated and it's not expensive. So absolutely true. Well, hey, just wrap up by telling us what's next for you. What are your plans for your shows?
Well, the main thing we're doing right now, sort of the new series that we're doing is, as I mentioned before, the Riddles in the Dark series. We're looking to kind of expand this as, of course, we move towards, I know in my world, this has been looming large for years, and we've been talking about this and watching it develop ever since about 2009, actually, the new Peter Jackson blockbuster treatment of The Hobbit that's going to come the first half this fall and the second half next fall. So in the Tolkien world, that is like the big thing that's coming and everybody's excited about. So we're doing a lot more kind of talking with that. I'm very interested to see if there are ways that I could actually work with Peter Jackson's people. I would love to get in touch with them. That's one thing that I've been kind of working on. But anyway, I am, you know, we're excited to kind of continue that. We've started this whole prediction game where we have partners from other podcasts and some bloggers and some other professionals. I've got a representative of Houghton Mifflin Harcourt, Tolkien's publisher, and my publisher also, of course. And I have some other scholars and people coming in to do, and we're all doing, we have this big predictions grid where we're sort of guessing what's going to be happening in the film and stuff. So it's sort of a lot of fun. So that's one of the main things that we're kind of thinking about. But of course, for me, the big thing for me is the development of the Mythgard Institute. And we're doing online classes. We're starting to kind of branch out. We began with really just sort of pure niche classes, which we still are going to continue. Mythgard is always going to retain a focus on Tolkien studies and fantasy literature and stuff. But we're also branching out into wider fields. My goal there really is nothing short of providing a really dynamic educational alternative to high-priced brick-and-mortar education, where people can pay a great deal less for really high-quality, interactive live teaching.
Hearing this from a professor is blasphemy, you know.
I know.
They talk about the military-industrial complex. How about talking about the college and tuition complex? I mean, it is unbelievably. Let's call it the university student loan complex. How's that?
Yes. Well, see, here's the issue there, of course, is that the professors themselves, though they're in many ways kind of ideologically invested in it, it's not like they're profiting financially
not directly from this tuition thing.
And so, in fact, it's one of the things, I mean, as a business model, it's one of the things that has been kind of a core business principle for the Mythgard Institute, is that I think by actually leveraging online technologies, I can provide an education which is of a really high quality with, as I say, live interactive small classes with really good professors, which will cost people way, way less, and yet actually enable me to pay professors better than they get paid at other schools. Because it's amazing. It's amazing how the budget is altered when you remove the multi-million dollar buildings from the equation. It really changes the scene a little bit.
Fair enough. Absolutely. Well, hey, it's been great talking with you. I know it is late in the evening in Delaware. We appreciate you staying up late to talk to us, and just keep up the good work. Do give out your websites though, before you go.
Oh, sure. The main website for my podcast is www.tolkienprofessor.com. Just one word, Tolkien Professor. And my institute's website is www.mythgard.org. That's mythgard.org. And you can also find this sort of parent university that is we're building in partnership with the Mythgard Institute is signumuniversity.org, signum university.org. www.wealthsociety.org.
Fantastic. Well, Professor Corey Olsen and podcaster Professor Corey Olsen, thank you so much for joining us today. We appreciate it.
Thank you for having me. This was fun.
Copyright the Hartman Media Company. For publication rights and interviews, please email media@jasonhartman.com. This show offers very general information. Opinions of guests are their own. Nothing contained herein should be considered personalized, personal, financial, investment, legal, or tax advice. Every investor's strategy and goals are unique. You should consult with a licensed real estate broker or agent or other licensed investment, tax, and/or legal advisor before relying on any information contained herein. Information is not guaranteed. Please call 714-820-4200 and visit www.jasonhartman.com for additional disclaimers, disclosures, and questions.